Welcome to the August 24, 2022 Environmental Management Commission meeting. I'm Georgine Adams, the chair with District 9, and we have most of the commissioners available, but one will be joining us late. So I'd like to go through and just roll call, wave your hands so people who are on can see you. We have Elise Robinson from District 2, John Olson at District 4. He's at the public site in Kona. And thank you for driving to the meeting, John. It's great to get good connection going with you. Melissa Cardwell from District 5 is remote, and will you be with us the whole time or?
No, I can only stay for an hour.
Okay, we'll try to scoot your issues along quickly. Lee McIntosh from District 6, rather. Steve Fulton from District 7, there you are. Rick Gaffney will be showing up about 15 minutes late, he said. He's from District 8, and as I said, Jane Adams from District 9, and call this meeting to order at 9:02. Our first agenda item is the approval of minutes, and I think we've got five people who are actually present at our hearing with Kyala Partners. And as I'll ask you up front, since we have three sets of minutes from those hearings, if anybody has any corrections that need to be made to the three? Seeing none, Peter, could you do a roll call vote? Or I guess first we need a motion to accept. Do we have to do each one individually or can we do them as a bunch?
You can do, let's see, agenda items, Roman numeral 2, 1, 2, and 3. So a motion to approve the minutes in the agenda as stated in items, Roman numeral 2, 1, 2, and 3.
Can I have such a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes of agenda item 2, Roman numeral 2, 1, 2, and 3.
A second?
I second.
Melissa, thank you. All in favor, say aye, raise your hand, however you want to do
aye.
That. Aye.
D? Thank you. Okay, I see five votes aye. Any nays? And just for the audience, John Olson was recused from the hearing, so he's not voting on this. So that's five ayes, meaning those finally have passed. And we'll go on the record. The next one item is our July 27th. 2022 meeting minutes, Roman numeral 2, 4. If someone can make a motion or to accept those minutes.
I make a motion to accept the minutes of the July 27th meeting.
A second? Elise?
Second.
Second. Mm-hmm. All in favor, or are there any corrections? Since I didn't let anybody say that about them last time. No corrections, can I have a vote? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, the minutes of July 27 are adopted. Thank you. Statement from the chair, Jesus hot. Other than that, I guess I don't have a lot. Unfortunately, I've been traveling most of the month. I'm very appreciative of you guys all taking the effort to be at our meeting. I was catching up on some news and saw that that can be a real issue with various boards and committees and commissions and whatnot to get sufficient attendance, even to be able to do any business, certainly to have quorum. And we've been doing pretty well on that, and I appreciate it. I'll talk a little bit more about thoughts on and how the commission is working later. Next, we'll move to item Roman numeral 4, public statements. Are there any members of the public who would like to give testimony?
I would.
Did I hear somebody?
Yes, Jerome Warren.
Oh, hi, Jerome. Which item would you like to speak to, or would you like to wait until we get to that on the agenda?
Well, you never get to this till the end of the agenda, so it's wastewater again.
Okay.
And, I can't stick around that long, so I'll go now.
Thank you.
Items Roman numeral 7-2-1. The county has no legal right to collect a fee for the illegal gang cess. Now, a high school senior read the County of Hawaii ordinance, which enables our sewer department to charge Kau residents. A lot of people can read that law, but any law student can see the law is in error. It's an illegal operation. That's the gang cesspool. Mm-hmm. Law is an error. However, no law professor will point that out. Plantation homeowner who doesn't pay their sewer bill will be taken to court. Judges do not recognize that the fault belongs to the law. A jury would recognize this and turn in a not guilty decision. Judges will turn in a guilty decision. Again, the fault belongs to the law, not the citizen. This law is bogus. Aleu's sewer meeting is next week. Guilty or not guilty, we are still on shaky ground when we start another round of sewer meetings. This is Plan 5, the fifth spin. It all started back at the beginning of this new millennium. Today, the pettifogging and the corruption continues. Our Kau students have seen this boondoggle all of their lives. Their neighbors have gone to court for not paying, and their relatives have been arrested for not showing up for trial. Not blame the citizen. Blame lies on the law. In summary, since this department does not reveal what legal grounds the county stands on, the citizen can only assume that the county has no legal right to collect a gang cesspool fee.
Thank you, Mr. Warren. Is there anyone else in the public that would like to submit testimony? Hearing none, we'll move on to our next agenda item, which is unfinished business. And first off, give the opportunity for those of you working on your private priorities for commission this year, if you'd like to provide a report. I think we might circle back with Rick Gaffney when he shows up. I haven't seen him yet.
I'm sorry, Madam Chair, if I may.
Sure.
With the new changes to the Sunshine Law, I think we just need to make sure prior to each agenda item that we ask again if there's anyone who would like to give public testimony.
Okay. Thank you for that. That's Kira Wong speaking, our corporate counsel representative. Did anybody want to talk about their personal efforts? Seeing no hands raised, I will comment that there is an ongoing effort by the, gonna forget their name, the Committee on Government Operations, I think it's called. And I thought I had a copy of it here. Apologize. It's the Cost of Government Commission. And I was given as chair a set of questions, mostly dealing with administrative issues that may exist with the commissioner board. All of the county commissions and boards were given this survey. And basically, bottom line was, I think we're working really well. We had a time before where we had vacancies, number of vacancies on the commission, and that was very frustrating. But right now we just have one. And if anybody knows anyone who'd be interested for district three, make sure that they apply and can join the commission.
Is that Hilo, Georgine, District 3?
Yeah, basically. Okay,
South Hilo.
Although,
or North Hilo.
Yeah, the lines are going to be shifting, so I'm not sure as
to. Oh.
Dee, you had a comment?
Yes. Georgine, I take it you are the person that needs to respond to this request for report of functionality of the commission.
Yeah, it was actually the biggest issue we commented on was from Peter on just the ability to put on these meetings, the AV equipment, and is there enough? And holy cow, what happens when he goes on vacation and doesn't have a backup? So it was those kinds of questions.
Okay, so it was a solicitation about the technical workings of the meetings.
Yeah, pretty much. Okay. And I'd be happy to send the comments that I've already sent in to everybody if you'd like to see them. But like I said, they were kind of non-trivial. I said again how they asked the question of whether you Zoom or in-person meetings or both, and said how we definitely all preferred, from an environmental standpoint, the ability to do Zoom meetings. But still we need to have a location for people who have tough times on connecting. And that's why we have a meeting where John happens to be sitting, John Olson. So
you know, Georgine, this is off topic, admittedly, but it might not be a bad idea, and we can talk about this next meeting, to do an annual efficacy follow-up, to send a letter to the mayor and the county council saying, here's our steps that we had recommended on action, and this is the effect that we saw. We can talk about that another time.
I think that's a different topic and a worthy one to do, and let's you and I figure out a way to phrase that up for next meeting. Because we have written many letters, and have some positions and just reminding people, hey, we've done these things, let's review and see where we are, is a good point. So thanks, Dee.
Just as a point of information.
Yes.
In the past, a somewhat distant past, all of the council's offices were available for testimony on anything that came before the council. So the fact that we've kind of, even though the need is increased, we really haven't held the ground that we once had in terms of public availability.
Well, definitely, John, I did Karis. Offer that as a suggestion in my response.
Yeah.
Kira. Thank you. This is Kira Wong. I don't think this relates to any agenda item, and my concern is that we are veering away from what's been noticed to the public. So my recommendation would be that we agendize this on the next September agenda, and then that way you can share the comments that you provided to the Cost of Government Commission with the other commissioners, and then everyone can have an opportunity to discuss it. And if it's necessary, we can compile the commission's comments and then we can send it to the Cost of Government Commission. And I also advise that commission. So I think that would be the most efficient way because they have a deadline to draft recommendations. So for right now, I think if, you know, pursuant to Sunshine Left, we stop this discussion and we put it on the next agenda.
Okay, great.
Works for me.
Rick Gaffney. Thanks, John. Well, I will send that out and we'll get it up on the next agenda item. Rick Gaffney from District 8 has joined us. Thank you, Rick. Where was I at my agenda? Since the next two items under Roman numeral 5, item 2 are associated with you, if you wanted to talk any more about your own personal priorities, or if you want to dive right into the master sewer plan for North Kona, take it away.
You're talking about the gray water discussion and the master plan?
Not gray water. We decided to postpone gray water for another day, specifically under Roman numeral 5.2.1. You provided us with a 2006 sewer master plan and North Kona Improvement District projects related to our discussions around having a master wastewater plan. We learned that there is indeed one for North Kona. And if you had any comments about that or if others had questions, let's address that now.
Well, yeah, just as a reminder for the commission, we've asked the council to look into doing a master plan for the entire island. And our director has responded that they are actually in process of developing two pieces of that master plan. The funding exists to proceed with that. And the two areas that the master planning is proceeding is our Puna and essentially South Kohala, based on and focused on Puako, based on money that came available through Representative David Tarnas last session to begin to solve that problem. So the concept of doing an island-wide master plan exists, continues to exist, and the need is there. I've spoken to the director about it. He definitely feels that it would be valuable. It's likely to be something that the EPA could demand of the county. And so this 2006 sewer master plan is interesting in that it exists and we didn't know about it. And I've been on the commission for a little while and it's never come up before. And secondly, it's another good example of planning that ends up sitting on a shelf rather than being implemented. A lot of the things that we've talked about that need to be done in the North Kona district, which of course focuses around the Kealakehe wastewater treatment plant, were seen as essential in 2006. And yet little or nothing has been done in that direction. So I think my main takeaway from reading this master plan is that it's just another example of the county administration kicking the can down the road and ignoring work that's gone into producing something. And I agree with Georgine, this master plan has an advantage of being something that we can use as a template to grow into the larger master plan process. Georgine and I have also been in discussion about this master planning process. And we agree that this is something that should be undertaken by a consultant with engineering, wastewater engineering experience, because that's something that none of us as commissioners have, either, you know, background training or experience. So the master plan really is something that needs to be funded. And that's something that we need to take back to the council. So that's my broad overview of this issue. And if anybody's got any questions, go ahead.
If Ramsey's listening, you indicated last time that you two were looking at that old plan. Have you had a chance to come up with your own responses to it and how it fits in with the bigger scheme?
Good morning. I talked to Peter yesterday and he gave me a hard copy of the North Kona Improvement District project. Rick is right. It seemed like back in 2006 that got some attention because they thought there's going to be some big development taking place. But in talking to staff, my understanding, the development did not go through, and that's why the master plan did not go through as well. So somehow the developer backed away. And the reason they did that master plan with the idea to help that developer to lay the ground of how he's going to be building his infrastructures. So technically, we are under the mercy of development. So if developers wanted to come and develop, they have to build the infrastructure that provide the services to their development. And if we don't have that, then the master plan becomes stagnant. So it's beyond the county's control because we cannot force developers just to go ahead and develop. So it's, the county did not kick it down the road. It's just developers backed away. So yeah,
I was kind of looking at it briefly. I have to admit my eyes started crossing as I was reading everything. It was quite long. In terms of the outline that we put together, what we'd like to see in the master plan. What one of the items that we had in there was the idea that it would be periodically reviewed and it wouldn't just sit on the shelf and say, well, no development, so we don't need to do anything. And also just the larger context of what are the basic goals for the island? What are we going to try to prioritize? And how does this particular, I've been calling them mini masters, fit together to meet our overall goals. So there are elements that I was trying to see what was in and what was out, not covered. It also looked like there might've been some controversy with this contractor finishing the job. I don't wanna go into all that, but the goal that I think the EMC shares is that we have this general concept of what a master plan means and how it's going to be kept alive. And that it needs to be revised because plans change. I was trying to match up my memory of, well, what does North Kona look like compared to what's all in this, all these maps that weren't so easy to read. And yeah, big plans didn't materialize. And that's life. And our plans need to match up more or less with life. Are there any other comments people have looking at that?
Yeah, in addition to that, Georgiana, Rick is also right about we need probably have county council once the county master plan, the big picture is completed, they need to adopt that plan similar to transit. So at least that become the roadmap and you cannot deviate from it. So maybe that's the route. Probably could guarantee that council will continue as they move forward in the future to refer to that map without deviation, or if there's any deviation, has to be approved through a process.
Yeah, I think it was that earlier conversation, which we'll have next month on the need to just evaluate on a periodic basis. Is what we did before still valid? Do we need to tweak it? How? and get that memorialized as well.
If I can weigh in there.
John Olson has a comment.
Pointing out to you that the east side and west side in terms of planning is very different. Pretty much over on my side of the world, all of the subdivisions exist. And the planning for those, I was just seeing here that the Pahoa wastewater feasibility study is back on the list. I mean, that, as I recall, we did first in 06, somewhere around there. And it's just now coming back to life. The number of lots that we have to deal with there and the topography and all of those things are going to prove to be extremely challenging. And these people are all under the gun, and the county and the state. And of course, the state has, I think, a stake in this because they allowed this to happen also. So, FYI.
Okay. Again, the need for a master plan that kind of takes accountability in place and is a living document. Were there any other comments? Lee McIntosh.
Yeah, Commissioner McIntosh, it sounds like that unless the area has already been developed, sounds like the county wouldn't be able to come up with a master plan, because you're taking land that is being rezoned and changed. So it would be hard to imagine or plan for what could be imagined for that area. So that may be another obstacle and why probably the county hasn't done much with it, because they're, why are you going to spend a lot of money to put something out there when, and if you're bound to it, that's limiting your growth and what you can do. So it sounds like you need like a master plan that as development is being proposed, that they have to come up with a plan for that area, rather than trying to guess, okay, we have 30 acres here, this is what we want to do with it. With a master plan, just leave it, focus on what development we have, and then as a developer comes along and wants to change it, then the county can either, I don't know if the county makes a master plan or if the developer makes it, then maybe that would be another way to go about it as well.
I don't know, Ramsey, if you want to address that, but my understanding is that you basically come up with scenarios of what could exist, and it's all under the larger planning plan, whatever that's called, for the whole island. So it's a lot of jigsaw pieces that fit together, acknowledging that, yeah, the future's going to change and you got to relook at it and see how it changes. Hopefully you've been smart enough to think of the potential future scenarios and what would need to be done at that time. And I think that was done in part in the 2006 North Kona plan. Rick, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I wanted to confirm what Ramsey said about the developer. The developer was Jacoby Development, and they were gonna develop over 1,000 acres adjacent to Honokahau. And part of their plan was they agreed to take over management of the wastewater treatment plant. So this improvement district project had kind of a different twist to it, because a major developer was going to take over the responsibility for managing all of the wastewater coming in there. And of course, then they also intended to use the water, because there were a lot of water features in their development, and they were going to use recycled water in those water features. So anyway, there, if you go through the plan, there are valuable things there. And that area where Jacoby was going to go has a DHHL property of some 400 acres, which they are planning to develop at some point in time. So clearly we're still gonna need wastewater considerations for that. And the Honokahau Harbor 2050 Commission meets regularly and is planning for the future of the harbor. So it's clear that there's going to need to be a number of the things that were in this improvement district as well. So, but Ramsey's correct that the developer moved down. 2008, the developer felt that they were never going to get the permits necessary to proceed. And so they backed away, and in a way that made this master plan somewhat moot, but there is valuable stuff in it.
Did I see other comments on this topic?
I have a question, Director. Is there anything in here that you find valuable for the master plan?
Definitely. The 2000 report has some valuable discussion that could be utilized and capitalized as we move forward with the big picture of the master plan. Any information, any effort that was made is could be salvaged to some extent and utilized, but or updated to reflect today's events. So yeah, there's definitely anything will have a value to it.
I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm Kelly Hartman. I work for Ramsey. I'm the new environmental planner, and I'm working on the countywide master plans, as well as several of the regional plans. So we've recently, I was joining late to the meeting. So I just want to give you a quick update. We recently executed 5 regional plan projects in Punapahoa Town, Puako, South Kahala, Nalehu, and Pahala. And we're working on developing contracts for updating the North and South Kahala regional plans. And our goal is ultimately to stitch these all together into one master plan. And then I would be the point person for making sure that those plans get periodically reviewed. We're also looking at setting up a GIS map so we can visualize coverage for the master plan and providing that to the public. And we're setting up our website for public comments as well. So just wanted to say hi.
Hi, great. We'll get you on the agenda every once in a while then.
Sounds good. And I'll be coming to the meeting from here on out as well.
Or item number section 2, item 4, wastewater and master plans. But thank you, Kelly, and stay tuned. She'll give you an update on the wastewater feasibility and Polco area wastewater study. They are on the agenda today, so.
Right. We'll hit you up later, Kelly.
Yeah, we'd like to see you down in Pahoa too. Pahoa Main Street.
Okay, save that thought, John. Did you have a comment? No, okay. Like to move this along. We have a guest speaker, so, and during the window when Melissa is still here, since it was at her invitation, just want to do the status check on 522, the pre-treatment rules. Where are they, Ramsey?
The pre-treatment rules, do we have Dora or Chris on the line? Just to make sure they could give the update on the pre-treatment. I know staff are working with our corporation counsel on the rules for the pre-treatment, and we have a deadline coming up, I believe August 26 or 28, to deliver more of the documents to EPA or Department of Health.
Well, again, repeat that EMC would like to see the proposed rules and have the opportunity to comment on them.
Yeah, so, once we get the clear indication from our from Malia, then we could share it with you. As you all know, we cannot share it at this moment until right. we get green light from Malia.
Well, as I keep telling you, I'm going to leave it on the agenda every time just to bug you.
Sounds good.
Just quickly, 5.3 is the latest report on the cesspool work group. If people had a chance to look at that, and at the end of it, there were items for further discussion, and I just wanted to give an opportunity if people had some comments to add to Ramsey's notes to take to the next meeting. Elise.
Yeah, I had a comment, more of a suggestion regarding the tax incentives for the cost, covering the cost of converting some 50,000 systems. I'd like to suggest that the incentive be expanded to all households, not only specifically low to moderate income households, being that county by county, there's such a big difference in what's considered low income. For example, Maui, a low income is around 90, according to HUD, around 91,000 a year for a family of four, which in Hawaii County, that's the median household. And so there's just a big discrepancy on county by county. And why not provide that incentive to all households? Unless there's a reason that I'm not aware of that you can share.
I definitely will present that to them. I think it was a discussion. They did some study. They had a look at the financial and demographic, and they came up with across the board, they understood different counties. Income restrictions, of course, city and county versus Maui versus us. And I believe all that was considered, I'll bring it back up in the next discussion just to make sure that at least allow the opportunity. My understanding is they're going to try to, these are recommendations, is going to go to our elected official to become legislation if they decide to take on our recommendations. Mm-hmm. And they may modify it, they may add to it, they may ignore it. But the idea is the more recommendation we give that makes sense to assist our constituents in the conversion process, that'll be beneficial to all people that live in on the island and have an accessible to convert.
Melissa, you had a comment.
I have a comment. I didn't get a chance to read all of it, but I was reading a bit about the different, approved versus approval required. And, I read a little bit about that composting toilets, were on the list of alternative toilets. And I know that we have a Department of Health, shortage, because I think that was one of the caveats with the approval required, is that it would have to go, there'd have to be a DOH, process. But I guess I just wanted to comment that, and I'm not a composting toilet expert, but what I do know is that they are incredibly affordable. And if we're talking about money, because it always comes down to money, that this is billions of dollars that needs to be spent to convert cesspools, to septic, that composting toilets, if there was a pathway, for the approval process to be fairly easy, that would be a more affordable pathway. Also, just in regards to the fact that the Big Island is so heavily agricultural and there's a lot of farms and, the need for soil and et cetera, that I just think that it's valuable and worthwhile to consider that composting toilets would be a part of this cesspool conversion plan.
Yeah, I mean, these composting toilet usually for the people kind of live off the grid type of lifestyle. It's definitely, I wouldn't recommend to use the compost for ag use since it has still pathogens and did not go through the Title SRF 503 requirement. So it's not just like compost and let's put it on soil and use it for ag. It doesn't do that level of composting. You're gonna end up getting rid of that into your garbage can.
So I guess that would be my question then, are composting toilets going to be a legitimate and legal possibility for people, for instance, who do live off grid? Because just speaking from someone, you know, from Lower Puna, there are so many people in Puna living off grid, and it's a large percentage of people. And this has been an issue I know that's come up in our community in the past, you know, the fact that it's composting toilets would make a lot of sense.
I think, Melissa, you're right. I mean, you could work with the Department of Health, and if you live in off the grid, I don't see a reason why they're not going to approve it for you. But yeah, I mean, I could see that being an option. That's why it was introduced in the report as an option, but not to convert, you know, like I said, you look at our area within the west side, we have a lot of people on cesspools, and that probably is not adequate to convert them to compost. But SENA may approve it. It's based on case by case and the specifics that comes with it.
I can tell you from the Puna side that the State Department of Health has permitted composting toilets in Puna.
Yeah. I mean, they should. It's a good option.
And within the shoreline management area.
Yeah.
So there is precedent there.
Okay. Other comments, recommendations, Rick?
Yeah, I've got a question for Ramsey. Is the cesspool conversion working group looking at the reality that septic systems, if they're not perfectly built and managed, are really no improvement on a cesspool? And therefore considering being very specific about septic installations and their required management over time and so forth, to be sure that we're not going from one bad thing to another.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, definitely. I mean, this was the discussion that us being on the committee, city and county, Maui, us, and even SENA. The idea, if you have a cluster of homes, and they're trying to convert them to a septic, you still have the same amount of leaching into the ground. So definitely the option is to, prior to conversion, to start looking at the possibility of, could you bring sewer into that cluster of cesspools or septics? So, and that's where it goes back to Lee's earlier concern as the part of the master plan, because there's so many factors that could create a successful, or parameters that could make a successful master plan, is you have an existing cluster of development that is already developed, but yet you need to provide sewer to them. How can you bring sewer? Because now, you either need to create a district and go through a certain process, but you need to get 50+1% within that cluster adhering to that requirement, and they support an idea of creating the districts so we could start providing sewer service to them. So, and if they do agree and come together, then rather than convert into a septic, probably we'll provide the sewers system to them rather than septic. So yeah, all that options is, it's looked at. As you all know, it's really within the hand of Department of Health because they're the one who issue the permits. But part of the recommendation that we recommended to legislation as well to allow each county have the master plan, how they're gonna go about doing conversion, understanding the certain criteria, decentralized versus centralized versus the amount of clusters of cesspools or off the grid living. So the whole idea is try to put all that, connect the dots together to be able to assist our constituents here within the county of options.
I had a question, Ramsey, on whether or not you feel there's, and maybe for Kira as well, a need for a change to your charter, your ability to get more involved, more authority over the selection options that are going on, where you don't just say, well, if DOH lets the septics go, I guess it's okay, but some way that allows you to incentivize or require sewering and focusing on that as the best solution is to get it into a wastewater treatment plant.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, that could be a legal question. How could we work with Department of Health to take some of that, I guess, unless they delegate some of that authority to counties, if they're willing to. And that discussion need to take place with the Department of Health and trying to figure out what's the legal way to delegate some of that authority from DOH to each individual county.
Well, again, we've kind of been down this road in Puna, and it really comes down to what EPA will allow, because they're the final decision maker in this, and the state works with under that, and then the counties work under that. So you've got to get them to sign off on anything in the end.
Two different things, John. This law, it's a state law. It's EPA is out of it for the individual. EPA get involved if it's a cesspool, gang cesspool, two or more homes, that's where EPA get involved. But the current law that we deal with, it's a state mandated law, it's not EPA. So it's totally driven by the state.
I'm gonna call Chair's prerogative and close this conversation. Certainly, if any of you individuals have comments that you'd like to pass along to Ramsey, go ahead and give it to him, and he'll decide if he wants to take the comment to the work group. And we'll have him give a status report next meeting as well on what that group is doing. If I may, though, I would like to move us to new business while we still have Melissa here. Roman numeral six. We have an invited speaker, Monica Stone, to talk about some
survey. I'm sorry, Chair. Is there any public testimony for any of the items listed under new business, Peter?
Not received.
Okay, no. Thank you.
Okay, so what we're looking for is a presentation by Monica Stone. And I think maybe Evan, sorry, I don't know your last name.
Evan Lamb.
Evan Lamb, thank you. Mm-hmm. To talk about some survey work that they're doing, looking at issues around organic waste management for the island. I don't know if you had any introductory remarks, Melissa, or we jump right to Monica.
Yeah, so Monica and I met a few years ago now at the Zero Waste Conference on Oahu, and she and Evan Lamb and other people have been working on this issue of developing basically decentralized composting. And I think you can both, you know, speak a lot more to that, but she had emailed me at the beginning of the month asking if, you know, she could be a part of this meeting along with Evan to find out the historical issues and roadblocks there have been in the county of Hawaii as far as composting goes and creating an island-wide composting system. And they've also been talking story with people on the island about, you know, the composting that already has been happening. So, so yeah, I'm excited to hear from them and what they've been working on. Thanks for being here.
Yeah. Thanks for the invitation, Melissa. Aloha, Chair Adams and the other commissioners. Thanks for having us today. My name is Monica Rotstone, and I'm here with my colleague, Evan Lamb. He's going to be taking notes. So our objective today actually is to interview you guys, the commission, as a group, with a goal of understanding the history, like Melissa just said, of organic waste management and composting efforts on Hawaii Island. By organic waste, we mean green waste, food waste, fish waste, agricultural byproducts, paper and cardboard mostly. And to identify the key challenges and pathways to improving the current system. We're in the process of conducting a countywide community outreach survey in partnership with the local nonprofit Recycle Hawaii and the County of Hawaii Research and Development Department. Just so you guys know, this project is funded through the EDA's Build Back Better Regional Challenge Program. So if it's okay with you guys, I was hoping to ask you, the commissioners, a series of questions as a group, and maybe we can do a quick round of responses after each question if anyone has any comments. Evan is the project manager, and he will be taking notes. I have three priority questions, and if we have time, I have more, but I don't want to take up too much of your guys' time. Does that sound okay with everyone?
We'll see. And okay. Our director is disappearing at 11, so I'm not going to let you go forever.
Okay, no problem. Cool. So I'll just jump right in. The first, as we were alluding to, a municipal composting system has been in discussion for Hawaii County since at least 2016 that we're aware of. Can the members of the committee share their experience and perspective on the history of the system?
I have a question. So are you talking about the proposed site that was going to be in Shipman Business Park?
Yes, both. And before then, if there is a history before then that we're not aware of. Yeah, I'm sure there's a lot of history. So we're just trying to capture some history.
I mean, you're sitting next to 40 years of
history. Yeah, I was going to say, John could probably speak a lot to that. I know a bit about that Shipman Business site, but John could speak to the...
I'll have to introduce you to Dr. Weatherford.
Okay.
Because he was, so I am told, he's the first person who ever got a composting toilet approved by the State Department of Health. Mm. And he still lives out my way. And he can give you, he's got the credential and he's gotten it done. And I think that he has set up out here already some small scale facilities that have passed muster. So he can bend your ear on the topic.
Okay. We would love that referral.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Melissa, you want to give your perspective on the Shipman?
Yeah, sure. And if Ramsey's still here, he can correct me if I'm wrong about any of it. So my understanding is that there's currently a contract between the County of Hawaii and I believe Hawaii Earth Recycling? So that was the company that was going to be responsible for the municipal composting site that was going to be in Shipman Business Park. So unfortunately, that seemed to have fallen through, but there's still a contract in place with them until 2034 or something like that. Ramsey, you can correct me if I'm wrong about the date, but Ramsey, you can't... 2036, okay. So there's 2036. So that's another, you know, however many years, 14 years. But the county's in litigation with them right now. So I haven't been able to get more information about what's going on with all of that. But it seems like it did fall.
Let me just clear record. We not in litigation yet.
It's possible litigation. But, right. Yeah. Okay, so potential litigation. So there's not a whole lot of information around that, but the general, I think the public consensus is that something like that is not going to work for this island. Nobody is going to want to, people probably in HPP wouldn't even want to bring their organics waste to, you know, shipment business, let alone people driving from Kona to do that. So it seems like that idea has been shelved for now, but I, again, because of the potentiality of the litigation, there's just not a whole lot of information available about the specifics of that. And then on the other side of, I know that one of the issues has been, so there's all these different players involved with the composting issue. And I think one of the players is the, also the Department of Health, and having not enough staffing basically to, from the Department of Health side, to be able to proceed with any kind of efficiency with creating a composting. Because as you all know, there's pathogens that can be involved, especially with food waste. And so that needs to be dealt with from the Department of Health side of things.
Any other? This is Georgine Adams. I would direct you, rather than taking up a lot of time here, I was on the Solid Waste Advisory Committee that put together the Integrated Solid Waste Management Plan. And we've got large chunks of information written at the time when we thought that that shipment project was going to go through, with all sorts of varying understandings of the scope of the work. The concept of a centralized facility that would take and combine organic waste, which would include not just green waste, but food waste, as well as fiber waste, in a industrially managed facility that could take all those compostable containers that we now require the restaurants to sell that can't be composted anywhere here. Anyway, all that is kind of described in the book, but the basic issue is logistics, as Melissa was saying. How do we collect it all and get it to that single facility? And then once we got it and it's compost, how do we get it back out where it's needed? And the logistics period on this island are frustration, whether you're decentralized or centralized. How do we get material to a facility, and how do we make sure it's managed properly and it's not just put into a big pile of stuff that's going to catch on fire, which even our professionally managed site for green waste does still occasionally. And how do we make sure it's safe to be used as compost in your garden, growing your veggies? It's a monster issue. Michael Perrone, I assume you must be talking with him from Compost Hawaii on the challenges. He laid out for us a very comprehensive set of issues that you need to have a whole system in place, and you got to deal with the fact that this is the big island with a lot of people who have restricted resources available to them. So it's very frustrating to try to figure out what would be the most efficient, effective, safe operations. I think we're now moving more toward the philosophy of a decentralized system. If you could somehow combine it with the transfer stations so that you've got a natural collection point that people are going to go to anyway, but we still need to deal with all the other organics, the food waste that isn't going to pigs from the restaurants, and fiber, and whether or not we can make it make sense. I assume you talked with, blanking here, the people doing the shredding experiments for compost in Kona, Chantal, to use that waste, but it's just hauling stuff around back and forth. Hopefully some of that is being looked at in the life cycle assessment that Senna Berig is working on, of what really makes sense. So it's not simple. There are never any simple solutions. I live in an apartment building. We don't have compost available to us. So how do you deal with those kinds of operations? Read the ISWMP. Thank you. Anyone else want to comment about her question?
Go ahead.
I just had one more thing to add, which it just reminded me of. I know there's a complicated permitting process, and I think I remember talking to someone on Oahu about this, and I can't remember the person's name. But there's no permitting process. There's no differentiation between, say, you know, a household wanting to compost versus a restaurant versus, you know, a huge corporation. And so I know there's some issues around that. And I used to know more of the details a little while ago, but I do know that that's one of the main or one of the big roadblocks.
John, did you have comment?
Yeah, you look at the planning document for the KL transfer station and the planning document for the Pahoa transfer station, because all of those were supposed to have composting facilities of both green waste and other. And so that was gone into at some length.
Okay.
None of that ever got built. Yeah. You know, the county never came up with the money to finish either of those projects, but it's on the books.
Anyone else? We moved our question to.
Cool. So you guys have already kind of alluded to some challenges to the community when it comes to implementing a composting system. What are some key opportunities that you see for implementing new systems or decentralized systems?
Well, I mean, fundamentally, you can take all of the other islands combined, put them down on the outline of the Big Island and walk comfortably around it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, the scale of it is really the challenge. We're too big to be small, and we're too small to be big. You know, our population compared to like Oahu is still small, but we have a lot of area to cover.
Mm-hmm.
Years ago, I was involved with the same topic on Oahu, you know, and they didn't have any problem with it at all. I mean, because it's from any what direction you're coming, you're 15 minutes away.
Mm-hmm.
And they have freeways. So we have some of the poorest roads in the state.
Melissa.
I think with anything that's that hasn't yet been established, I think there's a tremendous opportunity to educate people just about compost, about the importance of using food waste. My one concern, and I think it is a really good idea if we could somehow utilize the transfer stations and have that be a collection point, but my one concern about that is that as most of us know, a lot of people just kind of want to dump everything in one place, you know, and I know you all have heard me say this probably a million times, but every time I go to take my little bit of trash, you know, the transfer station, I look down in that, you know, in that container, and there's just all kinds of stuff in there that could either be recycled or reused or there's, you know, whatever. And so until people are educated about the importance of compost, the importance of keeping things out of the dump. You know, I've talked to many, many friends who have no idea that the Hilo transfer or that the Hilo landfill is even closed. And when I tell them, you know, our stuff's all being shipped to or, you know, trucked over to Kona, they're shocked, you know? And so I think there's a real tremendous opportunity for education. And I think that if we're gonna be successful with this endeavor and getting compost off the ground, then we absolutely 100% have to spend some time and energy educating people. People have to know that the Hilo landfill is closed. They have to know that, you know, we have maybe 100 years left in the Kona landfill, if that, you know. They have to know that when that landfill fills up, then we're gonna have to dig another landfill, you know. And would we rather would we rather, you know, have be reusing our things so that we have soil, so that we're creating soil? But this is a whole, you know, it's part of a much larger picture, as you all know. But I really do think that that education is going to be hugely important, whether that's, you know, getting into schools, talking to kids, you know. Yeah, so I think there's a tremendous opportunity for education around this issue.
Lee.
This is Commissioner McIntosh. I think the probably the major issue is going to be the county council and the mayor, that they don't seem to view this as a really important funding issue. I personally don't understand it. I would think wastewater and trash management would be top on the list next to road management or utilities, but it just doesn't seem to be there. They just seem to try and limp along. And I think until you see a change in attitude and those that make the decision and how money is spent, it's always going to be a struggle.
One more thing I want to say, and I'm not sure if this fits in necessarily with your question, Monica, but I just read an article this morning actually about the number of tourists that are now returning to the Hawaiian Islands and the impact that the whole tourism industry has on our islands. And so of course, you know, there's, and I forget the numbers, but there are way more tourists visiting than our islands than there are residents. And so of course they're producing trash as well. They're producing food waste as well. And so I don't, like, this is just sort of a seed in my mind, but that needs to be considered in all of this. And I don't know if maybe there's money that can come from the tourism industry, if there's, you know, I don't know, a tax. I mean, I really don't know. This is just the beginning of an idea, but I really, being that we're in a place that is such a hub for tourism, and whether we like it or not, it doesn't seem like that's going to be changing anytime in the near future. We need to take that into consideration, that you know, there are people come, a lot of people going to our islands that are creating food waste and trash and, you know, organic waste and all of that. And so I don't know, they're like Lee said, the issue at the end of the day always is about money, and that there is never any money, there's never enough money to do this. And so where can that money come from? We need to be creative, you know, in our solutions about where we can get money. And I know, I think when you had written that email to me, I think you had included that, I remember at the end, you know, about coming up with the funding. So that that's a huge roadblock, is the funding.
Rick Gaffney?
Yeah, I following up on what Melissa said, and your question is, what are the opportunities? And one of the clear opportunities is to monetize this. Yeah. I'm not a huge fan of that. However, I know that Home Depot and Lowe's and Walmart and others bring in tons and tons and tons of packaged compost to this island that people are willing to pay for. Mm-hmm. So there's a definite dollar opportunity here. And I think both with wastewater and with solid waste, in this case, compost, people are clearly willing to pay to help the environment. And they're already buying compost to make their gardens more fertile and to, you know, help when they plant trees and so forth and so on. So I think monetization is an appropriate section of this that needs to be pursued, needs to be considered. And further to that, there's a dramatic change in the environmental cost of composting as we do it today, which is many people go and buy this stuff from Lowe's and Home Depot, and that had to be shipped in here at a very high environmental cost. So we will also contribute to reducing that cost if we can produce a product here.
Melissa.
To that end, yeah, I want to add to what Rick just said. So the another thing that, Mike, I remember Michael Perrone talking about is our card, because you had mentioned paper and cardboard, Monica. And another thing that's happening, and I'm not sure if this has changed recently, I kind of doubt that it has, but our cardboard, the cardboard that's being collected at the transfer station is being shipped off island. So we're not even using the cardboard that's being created here, you know, because that's an important, that carbon is an important aspect of compost. And so we need to somehow find a way to be able to take that cardboard from the transfer stations and incorporate that in with the with this composting system. And I do you remember, Georgine, the percentage of, like, when we did the when it was figured out, like, what's going into the landfill, the percentage, because the percentage of paper was pretty high because people are also continuing to throw paper and cardboard into the landfill as well, you know, into the trash chute instead of the cardboard. So that is being a highly underutilized resource.
On the other hand, they actually make money shipping cardboard.
But like Rick said,
we have the collection is alive and doing fairly well.
But we're shipping the cardboard in and we're shipping it out. So how much sense does that, make?
The net looks really screwy. And again, I'm hoping our LCA will explain that a little bit better. Call it an opportunity just to be on the positive side. The barriers to establishing a business on this island in this state are huge. And it is one of the reasons why we do not have anybody doing recycling to speak of on this island. We could pulp up and make new boxes. We could turn it into compost that was valuable, but somebody's got to do it. They've got to build a business and run it and have scale that lets them make money. They got to get through all the permitting and all the NIMBY that exists on this island. Tough, doable. If you want to do it. Somebody asked me, no, I don't want to run a business. But I think that's one of the opportunities that the county has, is how can we encourage good businesses that will feed into an ecosystem that works on this island. But it's all those components. If you remember the chart that Michael was showing, you've got to have generation at a steady rate. You've got to have collection. You've got to transport it where it gets processed, turned into another good, and then given back to people who can use that good. And the circle keeps going and people are maintaining it over time. They aren't getting, it's volunteer work and people are doing the collection off their bicycles. That's not going to run a business. You're not going to be able to maintain it. So how can we eliminate barriers, allow pilot programs to thrive on this island, to feed those materials back into good use on this island? Rick, you had a comment.
Yeah, just for purposes of the response to this inquiry, there are actually people doing that right now. In the Kealakehe, the State Ag Park at the bottom of Kaiminani, there are multiple companies doing composting right now, one of which does very high-end composting with the addition of various biological details to make it extremely attractive to gardeners, and they're selling it. There are at least three, there's at least two tree trimming companies that are based in that ag park that, as best I can tell, are composting everything that they're not taking it to the landfill. They're actually composting it on the ag park property. And then they're either using it as a Puna landscape or Puna nursery that's based in the ag park. They're using it in their own plant materials processes and also in their management of other landscapes. And then there's one guy growing turf who is making, actually two people that are making compost and selling it by the truckload. So there are people that are in the business now, and perhaps it would be good to interview them and find out what the barriers are to their being more successful, and also maybe reach out to other companies that, like landscaping company, I mean, tree trimming companies that have huge volumes of green waste, and ask them what it would take to get them to start composting processes in their own. So the businesses that are already in existence that are successful are facilitated in their future success dealing with these products.
Lee, did I see you have a question, comment? No, okay. Anybody else? John.
We finally come full circle. I should have paid for, when I bought this coffee, the cost of the disposal. That ends the whole problem. Show me the money, right? I pay for the disposal when I pick up the product. And I don't care whether it's an automobile or a D9. It lands on the island, you're gonna put money down. If you don't come and get the car, the money is already there. You come and get it. Whatever is left behind, we pay it up front. And all of this just goes away, just poof, and it's gone.
Abracadabra.
Yeah, what do you smoke there in Pune?
It always comes down to,
but you know, but John does have a good point, because I think that's partly why the High Five program has been so successful, is because there's money attached to it.
It works.
It has a place.
Comes on this island.
And again, I think the complication is it's got to be the whole system, not just one in the system. I'm going to have to make you wrap up in just a couple minutes, because we do have other topics we need to cover before 11, when all our DEM people disappear.
Sure thing. Would you like me to ask my last question, or should
I? Yeah, ask last question. I would also offer that if you want to send us the questions, we could distribute it to the commissioners and ask them to individually respond to you.
Sure thing, whatever is best for you.
I'm just saying, we don't have time for continued conversation today.
Okay, I'll follow up with the email, and you can distribute it and respond to me then.
Yeah, that would be great.
Alrighty.
But what's your last question?
Okay, my last question was, how does composting relate to other waste management issues on the island, such as wastewater, landfill usage, and recycling, which you've alluded to? But
we live on an island. It's all joined at the hip.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I guess I would comment in terms, it's what you're worried about most. In terms of risk to human and environmental health, our biggest issue, in my view, is wastewater. We have to treat the stuff that we are flushing down the drain or putting into our cesspools, whatever, because it is contaminating the environment, it is contaminating potentially the water that we drink and swim in. That I think from a health risk is the biggest issue. The landfill issue, and we've got some time, there are some tricks that can be done. It's a longer term issue. It is also very important. And a lot of that could I think be addressed with the education that Melissa's talking, because remember the top of the pyramid is don't generate the waste in the first place, and teaching people how to do that better than we do now. So that's my two cents. Anybody else? Big question.
Yeah, I'm like, I have to think about that.
So maybe one to send out to it so that we could give it some real thought. And
well, one thing I do want to say, though, just in so far as how they relate to one another, is if we're keeping the food waste out of the landfill too, then we're not having to worry about like the leachate. I mean, I know that there's things to protect, you know, from things leaching out, but it becomes a much cleaner system in a way. But I know there's more. I need to think about that question, because that's a big question.
Lee.
This is Commissioner McIntosh. Essentially, our philosophy should be whatever keeps stuff out of the landfill and makes it last longer, that's what we should work towards.
And in addition, whatever's a resource, because it's we're basically wasting a resource. And that's in my mind, the thing that bothers me the most is that this is a valuable resource and we're just simply throwing it away. And so.
Yep.
Anybody else? If not, I would like to thank you for doing this work and pulling information together. It's also very helpful to have it laid out and to have thoughts and looking at, okay, what are the next steps that are practical? And certainly EMC has a component to helping make things happen. We are supportive of the work of the Integrated Solid Waste Management Plan and the concepts. Unfortunately, a lot of that requires some really hard work on the part of DEM to work the details. And again, you're back to where's the money and where are the people who can actually execute. So an important set of information, and we really appreciate it. So send us the questions. I'll get it distributed out to everybody, and those who wish can send you their individual comments. So thank you very much, Monica.
Yeah, thank you so much, Monica and Evan.
Thank you.
Okay. Moving along, new business. I gotta get back to my thing. John, he's got some non-trivial issues he wanted to talk about under new business. And what I'm wondering, John, the discussion point under Roman numeral 6, item 2. Am I hearing somebody want to say something? Anyway, was a discussion about the need to create a vision, mission, goals for solid waste management in Hawaii County and possible recommendations, how best to create and establish funding for an island-wide approach to managing our solid waste and landfill diversion, given the challenges of a growing population. Could I ask permission from the group to move to the DEM reports at this point, because again, several of them, including Ramsey, have to leave at 11 and get their report in and then come back to this item from John on new business. Is everybody gonna give me a nod saying that's okay? I think Melissa's gonna disappear.
I gotta step off, but. I'll listen to the
wonderful recording that we have. Yes.
Yeah, I'll listen to the wonderful recording.
Okay. Thank you for joining us, Melissa.
Thank you.
So seeing no faces or absolutely no thumb down, let's move to agenda item 7, reports and correspondence, and hear from the director and his worker bees on solid waste and wastewater. Again, are there any comments, new comments on section 7 from the public? I don't hear any, so take it away, Ramsey. And thank you, John. We'll get back to.
Thank you, that was a great discussion, Melissa. Monica, I think she brought good questions. You have a great discussion, you all. And also hopefully Senna will give us an update, because I know most of these discussion that you guys have about recycling falls within Senna's section. So hopefully as she gives an update, she could point out where she's at on the public education and the LCA and et cetera, because I think that I know her and her section are working on these issues that was just brought up during the discussion. The good news, we did offer the position of the solid waste division chief to a person that accepted it, and he's going to start with us September 19th. He's coming from the mainland with extensive experience in composting as well. So hopefully I look forward to have him on board so we could at least start concentrating on addressing the bigger issues as we move forward. I know we've been running very thin when it comes to staffing. So that's at least the good news about the solid waste division chief successfully.
That's great, Ramsey.
Third one.
Well, I'll
hopefully
take
next meeting. I'll be here to. Yeah, hopefully in your next EMC meeting, he'll introduce himself. So thank you, Georgina. The definitely item number two. We're gonna have some service interruptions due to the Ironman event scheduled for October 6th, 7th, and 8th. So, because as you all know, highways and roadways are gonna be closed to allow for that competition. So therefore, we're not gonna be able to provide the services. We cannot be transporting waste from east to west during these times. So we're gonna have a backlog at the Hilo reload facility because of the highways down where the event is gonna be shut down. So definitely we would like to make sure that please the public to work with us during these days and try to limit your amount of disposal to the transfer station and the reload facilities because eventually some of that waste is gonna sit there till we reopen. So, and the Hilo reload facility, as you guys all know, it's limited to certain amount of tonnage to be able to store in that facility. So definitely the message out to the public is work with us on limiting, reducing the amount of disposal going to the transfer station and reload facility on the east side so we can navigate through that closure. The number three, recycling and landfill diversion. Senna, I see her name on the screen. Maybe she could log in and give you guys some update and maybe could address some of that question that came through your discussion. Go ahead, Senna.
Hey, good morning. We have an interesting discussion. It's too bad. Just so you all know, we are literally going to be talking to, we're going into a meeting at 11 o'clock about extended producer responsibility. So it's all related, just it's too bad that it overlapped. It was really exciting to hear the comments from members about the with respect to Monica and Evan's work. Excuse me. So updates, yes, on first and foremost, I can't even remember who said that, but the importance of moving the focus up the pyramid to reduce and reuse. The entire country, probably the entire world, is focused, has just been focused on recycling as it lends itself to, there's a market, you know, it creates that industry of recycling. So, but we are, our section, you know, we just finished a small campaign on reducing food waste at home. I hope some of you caught it. It's on our website under media or under resources. It's a little video just to encourage people to reduce food waste at home and the impacts that that does have. Excuse me. The LCA is, it's all the Parametrics has all the data and they're working their numbers. So I don't know when it's going to be coming back, but it's they're doing all their business over there. So there was never a discussion from them about this issue of utilizing the cardboard on island. That was not one of the options because just, you know, when this whole thing started, that wasn't something to look at. It just looks at shipping versus shipping and recycling versus keeping it versus age power as the different options. So, but all the work that's being done looking at decentralized is another great opportunity because I as well you know, it's such an entire paradigm shift of looking at this whole concept of circular economy. What Melissa was saying is true. It's like, it's not just the food waste to keep it out of the landfill. It's also that it's this great resource that can be utilized. And essentially at the same time that we're shipping compost onto the island. So if we can keep material on and not be paying and all this, so just not only because it makes sense, but also reducing the carbon footprint on that. So it's exciting to hear that this has moved up the into higher purviews. The e-waste, there's been a lot of discussion about our e-waste program. Excuse me. We have, we ran out of money last year. This, you know, it's a state funded program that we administer here. A few years back, DOH took money out of e-waste, out of environmental programs because of COVID. So now our budgets, we've been working on a much smaller budget. Last year, we ran out of money, you know, quickly, because also tied in with COVID is also that everyone's buying more TVs because they're staying home and computers and new stuff at home. So what we're doing now is, and also to address the desire to have some sort of collection for businesses on the west side of Hawaii. You know, everyone knows that we just have one recycler on island currently, Mr. Kays, that does our e-waste recycling. One of the council members has been asking for a long time, and I was directed to try to work that to the contractor looking at our collection, was to bring in the possibility for businesses, small businesses, to bring their e-waste to an event on the west side. So we are in the process right now working with our vendor on coming up with a, there'll be a few events, but right now it's all going through the bidding process and the procurement and all the slow, boring stuff of our inner workings of the government. But we're looking at having potentially 6 events, and they'll be similar to the events that we've had, but there will be opportunity on the west side for businesses to bring their material, and then it'll be weighed and they'll be charged to just for disposal on the west side. You know, our apologies for how long it's taken, but it's the way it is. You know, we ran out of money really early on last year and had to subsidize it with solid waste money. A good part of it is come October, the manufacturers will be required to come up with a plan to be paying for it. So it's a similar with the EPR. It's not quite an EPR program, but basically getting money. If you want to sell TVs and computers on the island, then you have to help pay for the recycling of them. So they're supposed to come up with a plan to DOH, I believe, in October, and then it's supposed to be in effect in January. That's the plan. As everything else, DOH is understaffed, but that's, as far as I know, that's what the plan is right now. And then we have no idea what that's going to end up looking like for us, but we do know it means more money for e-waste collection on the island. So that's really great news. Some not so great news is it's just a challenge that's going with this labor shortage. Is Volcano, 3 months ago, the Volcano High Five program was extended, the contract for collection. The days of service were changed. It was out for bid recently, and we have no bidders on that. They literally cannot, there's not enough staff. They don't have the staff to be putting a CRC for the high fives in Volcano. We are working, putting back out, trying to get community involvement, nonprofits or schools or whatever, but they would also have to be partnering with the actual recyclers as well. So we are working really hard at finding solutions to this. However, at this point in time, I think it's at the end of this month, there will not be the high five in Volcano, but it's a temporary, we're working hard to get a solution for that. So if anyone knows of any volunteer groups, community groups in Volcano that's interested in working on this for their community, then please let me know. That's really the higher stuff I can think of. Everything else is moving along. No real comments on the HER and all that stuff. But the mulching programs are going well. Everyone loves the mulch. It's great for the community on so many different levels. It's especially helpful on the west side when it comes to the water retention. So if there's any specific questions, I'm happy to answer those about any of the programs.
Does anybody have any questions for Sena?
I
Looks like you can go off to your meeting, Sana. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I hope you're feeling well.
Getting there, thanks. Thank you.
Oh, Sana, will you share the results of anything from your meeting coming up with the commission?
Oh, yes, absolutely. So yeah, we have Heidi Sanborn. She's like the queen goddess of EPR in the country. So she's going to be talking on it. I'm really excited to hear. Of course, it's, you know, she comes from California where there's a lot more people, a lot more rigs and a lot more abilities to do this. So, but yeah, we're really excited to be working with her, but absolutely, I will share that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sana. Okay, moving on to wastewater.
Yeah, thank you, Sana. Pahala Nalehu, as you all know, we were successfully negotiated a revised AOC, and we're going to have a public meeting scheduled for next Wednesday, August 31st, to go over the new revised AOC requirements and options. West Hawaii wastewater projects. You know, as far as on the west side, we are working on the Kalakea treatment plant. Our consultant is working on two projects, one the sand filter, the other one is the headwork and water control. These projects, you're probably gonna see them on the list because it's not kind of quick project. It takes time and probably, by the time it finished construction, we're talking about probably 2 years or so. So you probably may end up seeing them. We had a big opening yesterday for one of our pump station roof. Unfortunately, with the construction market out there, we only have two bids. The second bid was twice as much as the first one. And it's just amazing the cost escalation of construction cost. It just, things are going way high, more than what we anticipated in the budget. We anticipated about $200,000. It came at $442,000, the low bid, twice what we budgeted for. So we're gonna anticipate, we may see that more often as we move forward with these construction escalation, construction costs, and delay in supply lines, and it's creating definitely a challenge to the county and to the budgeting process.
Rick Gaffney has a question.
Ramsey, can you be specific on what exact wastewater project you're talking about that's run into this cost overrun?
The one we have, the project that we did, which we had the bid opening, is the roof project for the sewer pump station 19. The roof has been leaking right into our MC, the main control panel. So the project came twice the amount of what we budgeted for.
Okay.
Just to do the roof, it came out $442,000, and the second bidder was almost close to $700,000 just to do the roof for that building. It kind of gives you an idea that things are not going to be easy moving forward. So with the Hilo waste treatment plant upgrades, we have, you know, the design is going to be submitted to us by the consultant also next Wednesday at 50%. So we're moving forward on schedule and within time. So our intent to put Hilo out to the bidding process, phase one, probably by March, early next year. And we're going to keep our finger crossed as well. I'm just hearing that the construction as well for that project may way go over our budget as well. but let's keep our finger crossed as we move forward. Wastewater master plans, I have Kelly here on the line. She could give you guys an update on these two master plans. Kelly?
Hi, so I introduced myself briefly earlier. I'm Kelly Hartman. I'm the new planner, environmental planner for DEM. I started 3 months ago. So we have several projects going on. We're calling them regional plan projects for Puna, Pahoa Town, Puako, South Kohala, Nalehu, and Pahala. And we're working to developing contracts for North and South Kona. And the goal is to complete those feasibility studies and cost studies, and then stitch all the regional plans together into one master plan. And like I said, my one of the concerns brought up was making sure there's periodic review. And so that would be one of my roles as well, to make sure those plans get reviewed and updated periodically. So I could give you some details on what's going on. Do you want me to go into details on the like the different projects, or is that a separate agenda item?
I guess the question is whether there are any other commissioners that have questions on Puna Puako.
Okay, yeah, any questions?
Kelly, definitely make sure we have the public hearing coming up for the Puna Wastewater Feasibility Report in October, correct?
Yes. Yeah, we have a public scoping meeting scheduled October 12th from 5 to 7 p.m. at Cal High School cafeteria. And the purpose of that meeting is to gather comments on the project definition and developing the programmatic environmental impact statement. We do have the EMC on the distribution list for all of the public notice and for the public meeting. So hopefully you'll be seeing something on that.
So you,
John, did you have a question?
Well, yeah. So I'm because you're using the school complex to hold the meeting, I'm assuming the schools are going to be connected, the elementary, middle, and high school, to the Pahoa system.
So the feasibility or the facility plan is just getting kicked off now, and so that will be to be determined. But you know, we will be bringing in all comments.
To answer your question, John, the intent of the feasibility study to look at how any connection or maybe decentralized package unit or treatment plan that could be feasible or not for that particular area. So the consultant is looking at the feasibility of providing wastewater services to these communities. And yes, the school will be part of the study, of course, because it's part of the community as well.
Yeah, okay. So, and I guess, are we planning for expansion of Pahoa? Is it, you know, the commercial side of Pahoa? In other words, the capacity of this will be large enough to accommodate additional commercial expansion.
Yes, all right. And to work with the planning department, as Kelly would be working with the planning department and the consultant to make sure that we capture any upcoming, the 2040 general plan, if there's any commercial growth and residential growth, all that's gonna be captured as part of that study as well.
Yeah, because of course there's the planning that the Pahoa Main Street has done over the years and the visioning that it has had going forward. Just to get it on the table, Old Pahoa Town is predominantly in Hazard Zone 2, where you go to the other side of Kahakai Boulevard, and you are now in Hazard Zone 3. So development out to the north end of the town is what is more likely based on that. And any other new developments would be focused going in that direction.
Definitely, as you know.
But anyway, you're going to have a scoping meeting. We'll certainly have more to say about it.
Yeah, definitely. Please make sure you attend the meeting, John, because you bring wealth of knowledge and institutional memories to the process. So,
we did get grant money. We've gotten grant money on several occasions from different sources to do long range planning for Pahoa. Yeah, so that we've got a layout that was professionally done.
Yeah, and also the planning department's about to execute a contract for a Pahoa Town master plan. And so we're working in coordination with the planning department on that, as well as any existing community plans and, you know, the population projections that the planning department has.
Yeah, well, and we're going to invite you all down for a meeting with Pahoa Main Street, which is the group that's the point on it.
Sounds good. And we also attend the Revitalized Puna meetings too. So it's nice to meet you. We'll meet in person soon.
Okay. Thank you.
I think that's one of the concerns, if I understood you, Lee McIntosh had, of how do you project what's going to happen? And so how big of a plant, where are the facilities you need to locate them? And we have these multiple planning processes that exist. And the coordination. So I guess one of the questions as a EMC is how you're working with that planning department. Is it timely? Are they giving you the cooperation that you need? If I read it right, and I read it really fast, there was an article talking about how they're going to get rid of public advisory committees for the planning department because they can't get enough people to participate. And it's just the same old people being rolled over every year. Nah, I don't know about the politics behind all that, but you know, the issue of, is there really planning going on? How fulsome is it? How reliable is it? Who's watching? Who's making the adjustments periodically? And if there's something that, you know, we could do as EMC to say, here are the needs we've got to have met, we can go to the council and to the mayor's office and say, you know, this is important to have something that is reliable for DEM, because you're not the ones in charge of where development's going to occur. You've got to rely on others.
Yeah, so we also got that notice I saw yesterday that the community development groups are hopefully temporary being disbanded due to staffing issues. The first thing I did when I came into this position was, you know, try to develop a relationship with the planning folks. And so I have a few great key people over there that I've been working with, and they've been getting back to me on information. I think one thing the planning department, you know, we need to always have updated population projections, updated, you know, development information. And the Pahoa Town wastewater master plan we'll be working with. That's getting moved to Garrett Smith. He's going to be the point person from the Kilauea recovery team. And I believe they're meeting today to get direction from their director on, you know, how people are going to be shifted to support some of the ongoing projects that they do have. So we'll have more on that soon.
Good.
Now, as far as Puna is concerned, where development is going to happen has already been decided. That was decided in the 60s when they commenced to just randomly create subdivisions, whether there was any reason for it or not, or whether it was in the hazard zones or not. So that's a done deal. we know where people are going to go because the subdivisions exist. So now we have to provide the infrastructure to support it.
So those plans can never change?
No, not unless you want to buy all those lots back.
This is Commissioner
McIntosh. Lee, you had a comment.
That's Commissioner McIntosh, but you also have a lot of state land in that area that could easily be opened up for sold for development, which I know some groups are pushing for like affordable housing and stuff. So it's not set in stone. It could change, and you'd have to keep that in mind as well in planning.
Well, over time it will change, but I mean the major growth is still going to be involved in the build out process of what exists.
Yeah.
And that is substantial. So, and I'm well aware of the state lands that are there and the uses to which they are presently designated. Most of it is ag. But ag needs water too. The good news for us is that there is no shortage of water. When we did the water analysis of Puna, we have more water coming out from under Puna than comes out of the mouth of the Amazon River. Ah. End of story.
Okay. Move on to Puoco.
So from my table, Puoco. So the project was just executed in July. So it's on track. So AECOM is our contractor, and we have our external kickoff meeting scheduled next week. So we'll have more on that in the project schedule next week.
Okay. Any questions around any of the wastewater management plans? Rick, Gaffney.
Yeah, quick question, Ramsey. Has there been any progress with the North Kona pump station and the SHPTE block on the forward motion of that?
Since our last meeting, with you and DLNR, Sean has been working with our staff. The intent is hopefully we could continue pushing, accelerating the EIS. I have not seen any movement. Our consultant is working on putting together the response that we received. Hopefully, with your continuous assistance and us continuing pushing the project, hopefully we could see some movement, hopefully before the end of the year.
Thank you.
Anyone else? I said, we'll make the offer on my behalf, and maybe I could talk Rick into it as well. Kelly, if you would like to have us go over any of the background and thoughts on what should be in a master plan, what our concept is, and the issues that we consider critical. I assume you've received a copy of the outline that we provided. We would be glad to sit down with you or Zoom with you what we were after and things to look out for that we would be asking about. Again, our concern was not for you to just work on these individual regional plans and just staple them all together and call it a master plan, but that there is a higher level context for them all and principles being worked into them. So again, I make the offer that we'd be glad to talk with you about what did you mean when you put this down?
Right. In the meantime, I got only a few minutes, but in the meantime, I think maybe it'll be good for you to, if you have not done it yet, to review the scope of service for these two master plan that AECOM is working on, because really they have comprehensive detail on what to expect to deliver.
Yeah, I haven't gotten a copy of that. Did you get it, Rick?
Yeah, so please review it. Think of it as, you know, the parameter that we had to probably, as we move forward, to build from.
Okay, haven't received a copy. So as soon as I do, you'll hear from me.
Yeah, so Kelly, if you get a chance, just forward it to the commissioners. I'll be good, at least it gives you an idea of, when we talk about feasibility or master plan for these two communities, this is what we anticipate to get out of the consultant. So.
No, that'd be very helpful. I don't know if you had comments, Rick, or you want to hold them.
All right, I got to go off. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ramsey.
Thank you. No. Bottom line is, Peter did send them. I thought you were copied, but I haven't had a chance to do any more than just to glance at them. So I need to look at them in way more detail. But I clearly they're going to be valuable in that, in putting stuff on paper that we've been talking about, the communities have been talking about for a long time.
Good. And we'll report back to you guys on any thoughts we had in there. Also, maybe Rick, you could talk about the meeting you had with Haleka Inaba, the council committee for regenerative agriculture, water, energy, environment, and the kitchen sink. your conversation you had with him.
Yeah, well, this happened as part of the election cycle, but as all of you probably are aware, Tim Richards decided to run for the new state legislative seat that was created by reapportionment. And in so doing, he gave up his council seat. Haleka has been the vice chair of the Raw Weem and Kitchen Sink Committee. He wanted to be sure that there was continuity and the work that had been done as a result of the meetings that Georgina and I attended with Tim Richards and Haleka Inaba, who are chair and vice chair of that committee. And obviously Georgina and I are chair and vice chair of this commission. So that seemed like a logical way to be sure that the conversation continued. And Haleka was very concerned about continuing that. He, of course, can't be certain that he is going to be posted as chair of the commission, of the committee at the council level, but he's willing. And of course, there's a number of new council persons, so we don't know who the vice chair of that committee will be. But he's very willing to continue the conversation. And there's two things that we have reminded him that this commission has asked the council to do. One of them is to create an enterprise fund for wastewater. And the other is the master planning process that we've discussed for quite a while today. So the enterprise fund, where we've gone with that is we've provided Councilman Inaba and his chief of staff, Wendy Baez, with a direct contact with the person at the city and county of Honolulu Office of Council Services, who actually wrote the city and county of Honolulu's enterprise fund legislation, which was subsequently passed by the council. So the city and county of Honolulu and Maui County have wastewater enterprise funds, and Councilman Inaba's office is proceeding to create the legislation necessary to create an enterprise fund on this island as well. So bottom line, the transition looks like it will be very clean because Councilman Inaba is essentially unopposed, And it only remains to be seen who is going to be elected as chair and vice chair of that committee, which is important to our work.
Thank you, Rick. Any other issues around wastewater? Okay, and I'm gonna go back up to the new business item, Roman 6.2. John, this was a request from you if you want to characterize what you'd like.
Pardon me, Chair. Nope. Can I request a
break?
Yeah.
You need a break? Sure, let's take a timeout, as John indicates, for 10 minutes. 9 minutes. Come back at 11:10. Dee,
you go ahead. Georgine, I have a limited time today too. I'm going to fairly soon.
Fairly soon. Okay. That would still leave us with five people. So I think we're okay. Hello, welcome back to the Environmental Management Commission meeting. We are now going to go back to what we skipped on Roman numeral 6, new business, item 2, which is stated as a discussion about the need to create a vision, mission, and goals for solid waste management in Hawaii County and possible recommendations how best to create and establish funding for an island-wide approach to managing our solid waste and landfill diversion given the challenges of a growing population. Question, this has been raised by John Olson, and a question for you, John, given that DEM has left the building and the Zoom, do you want to do a discussion without them, which is perfectly fine. We can line it up for further discussion next meeting or what?
Well, it would seem that I've already beaten you to death with with my point of view on this already. So I don't really have a whole lot to say that's going to be new to our discussions with the other participants have led me down the road I was going on. So, you know, again, it's back to show me the money. It always comes down to show me the money. And we've got to collect the money from the front end of the horse, not from the back. It's just that simple. If it's in the bank, we take care of it. And everybody understands, the other part of that is everybody understands what they're paying for. Right now, the money goes into, for the public, a black hole. They have no idea what it costs to run a wastewater treatment plant. They have no idea what it costs to dispose of a disposable cup. If when I bought this coffee, I gave them a nickel and it came out on the receipt, I just paid a nickel to dispose of this. End of argument. And you can take that from, you know, this cup to a D9. What does it cost to dispose of it? If you end up leaving me with that challenge, what does it cost?
Once upon a time, I had on the agenda a series of questions to the DEM about the cost of disposal. Mm-hmm. I deferred it because one, they didn't have a solid waste chief. Two, Senator Barrick, but the only worker bee in the group was overwhelmed and so left it to be. We have a new solid waste division director. Our meeting in September is the 21st, I think. Is that right, Peter? 28. Should be. Anyway, so we're going to meet with him 2 days after he starts work, so probably shouldn't inundate him with a whole lot of demand.
I think Peter said September 28th is our next.
It's the 28th?
Yeah.
Okay. My bad. Good.
I mean, this goes to wastewater too.
paying the true cost. I think actually I have wastewater in there as well. Paying the cost of environmental management and making that happen is an important part. Again, kind of first steps, I think, would be trying to put together the story of what those costs are. And those costs are driven right now by the amount of money they have. And they divvy up however they can manage it. So there's still more work to get to. Well, if we were really doing it right, how much would it cost? And I think that is a valid question, but then somebody's got to work up the numbers. And again, the never ending issue of cart before the horse, they've got to have staff to be able to put that information together and data.
But I mean, the end result is we're doing it, so we're paying for it. You were already paying for it. You know, it just, we may not like the results of what we're paying for, because we're obviously not covering the ground we need to do an adequate job of it. But I mean, that's, again, pay me now, pay me later, but pay me you will. So,
one of the advantages of a high five program is that people can get their money back.
Exactly.
So is that the kind of system you're thinking about?
Well, certainly that's going to be included. I mean, it isn't just give me your money. But I mean, most reasonable people, if you show them the advantages of something, they're willing to pay something for it. I mean, I've been involved in this process since I became involved in, and this is going to sound totally disconnected, after the inundation, the law of the inundation of this county facilities in Kalapana, we started looking for a new site for another park to replace Isaac Hawley. And in that process, we came across literally thousands of abandoned cars in Pune. And I'm not kidding you, thousands of abandoned cars and trucks and other dumped things. And so that got us on this whole cleanup campaign, which is what led to this body being formed and being put on the ballot. That's how this organization came into being. And in that, we always visioned that it would be self-funding. It isn't simply a matter of you own a piece of property and you're going to pay for this. It is the users that pay what it costs to develop a waste control system. We did two transfer stations that were never completed. The Pahoa transfer station never had all of the facilities that it was supposed to. And the Keao transfer station was never completed. They just walked away from it, dropped the ball. I mean, we did manage to get little components of things in there, but the total picture was never blown out to be what it was meant to be. There was supposed to be a green waste recycling facility in both of those places. Goes in one end, comes out the other, available to the community. Didn't happen. I could go on, I won't.
Thank you. Again, I think it's the issue of DEM has to manage it all. Mm-hmm. And for the whole island, and they're given only so much money, and it is
a
good amount of money.
Yeah, so we collect.
So how do we get them an adequate amount of money? How do we help them make their processes more efficient so that they are
wasting money? Collect the money on the front end at the point of purchase. And this gets everybody the point at which they know what they're paying for.
Well,
I know that it costs a dime to make this disappear. I know that, right? Or it costs a nickel, or it costs 2 cents, whatever it costs. And so now I'm an informed participant in this. As it is now, it goes into a black hole and somebody says it's going to cost you $10 million. Well, what's it going to cost me $10 million? Why? Why is it going to do that? We don't explain that to people.
Does the county have the power to implement a fee?
Sure.
I believe we were told before that we do have the county can do user fees.
Yes.
And so it would be a user fee in terms of you, the user of this thing, is costing so much to dispose of the item. Yeah. A tax, a flat across the board thing, then it starts getting dicier. And if you'd like, we could ask for our corporate counsel to see what the extent of that authority is. I forget whether or not we'd gotten bits and pieces of it from Malia before from DEM counsel.
And would the public need to vote on that as well?
No. It's possible. I mean, the whole tax and fee issue is all kind of bollocked up with their state authority for counties to do certain things. And so
it's not a tax.
Nothing is a simple answer.
It's not
a tax. I don't know if you want to weigh in, Kira.
Wasn't this something that was put forth in the Solid Waste Integrated Management Plan? Or was this not?
We addressed various ways to fund.
Yeah, and we talked about it, but it has never actually been implemented. The county has the ability to create fees to cost to cover the cost of what it's mandated is. So at this point, solid waste is one of those things that is mandated that the county deal with. So the legitimacy of creating a fund to do that based on the actual purchase of something that you know is going to end up in the having to be dealt with by the county is legitimate.
So what I would recommend is, because I think, if I recall, Georgine, when you had brought it up initially, you had proposed funding options or areas that the DEM director is supposed to look into in consultation with the DEM deputy corp counsel. My understanding last was that he was going to follow up with her. I also followed up with her, I recall. I can try to find that correspondence. And then we didn't hear anything back. Of course, absent an agenda item on the topic, probably not going to come back, until we request for a status update, and especially now since the solid waste division chief is now on board, it might be a good opportunity, perhaps at the next EMC meeting, to have an agenda item on that topic, and then I can also go back and look to see if I received any response from either Ramsey or Malia on the research that they were supposed to do with respect to financing options and funding options.
I don't think we ever got a semi-official response to that. I can go dig back the work we'd done before on discussing funding and see if we can recast another request to DEM for next meeting, or maybe the meeting after that. Again, let the poor new solid waste chief get some legs under him before we blast him.
I go back in this quite a ways, and I'm trying to remember whether I think I've had this discussion back before there was a DEM, back when it was under the county's public, when the waste, solid waste, was dealt with by the public works, and it wasn't a separate entity, right? And we talked about it back then as to whether the county could collect a fee, not a tax, but a fee. So that's kind of what I'm running on. I assume that has remained the same, because we do charge fees, wastewater fees, whatever. So that is it, unless other things have changed. It's still on the books as that.
Lee McIntosh, you had a comment.
This Commissioner McIntosh, the county can charge a fee for throwing the cup away, but they can't charge, it would be considered a tax if you were to pay it before you bought it, that would be considered a tax. And that's why the state is trying to pass that, what's it called, an EPR or whatever, something along those lines. And also a complaint I've heard about the high five is that the state charges 6 cents and you only get 5 cents back, so they keep a penny. And so before they implemented that program, you could actually make money by taking the cans down to, you know, Mr. K's or whoever and get some money for it. And so if you start all this charging and stuff, you're going to stifle anyone who might be able to make money off it, because now the state and the county are stepping on their toes, and it probably needs more of a work together group rather than just charging money, at least for purchasing beforehand. If you charge to throw away, that creates its own mess of problems, but that would probably be more towards what the county would lean to. Of course, they've been talking about that for at least 10 years. So I know a lot of people don't support that.
Well, I mean,
Elise Robinson, sorry, please.
John. I'm also concerned about raising the cost of living for Hawaii residents by implementing a fee or an additional cost, when already, I mean, we know it's very expensive to live here, and the income, the medium income is it's around 90 grand for a family of four, which can go a long way in the mainland, but here it's considered low income. So I'm concerned about adding more costs to residents.
Me too. And I think that this actually, if it works the way it should work, it actually should become less costly, because the disposal element of it becomes less complicated.
Well, I think it is complicated in that it doesn't cost 10 cents to dispose of a bigger thing than a paper cup.
But we're already paying for it at some level.
Coming out of our property tax. It's being paid for for the most part. Does that mean our property tax should go down?
Well, or at least
we're gonna
not
pay
go
for
up.
It at the cash register?
Or at least not go up.
And but to John's point too, that does exclude a lot of renters, a lot of people who don't live here own property and rent it out. So renters don't contribute to the county expenses in a direct way.
Right. I mean, we're capturing full on the visitor industry, which per person, you know, we know from the surveys that have already taken, people who travel just dispose of more stuff. They don't want to put it in their bag and drag it home. So they buy it and they leave it. So that is a significant number, at least if you believe what the Visitors Bureau says, because they've already done the analysis.
Rick Gaffney, you had a comment?
No, I have a question. The solid waste management, well, number two under new business says discussion about the need to create a vision, a mission, and goals for solid waste management. Is that not what the solid waste management plan did? And if it didn't create a vision and a mission statement, then I think we can enter into that discussion. But if it did, and there's no reason to change it, then I think we just need to force the county to meet the vision and mission of that solid waste management plan.
I would say my opinion is that yes, that is in there. What we did for funding was offer options. I didn't select the option to go with, and it needs to be a multitude of options at that. I had summarized months ago, maybe even last year, the various funding revenue and a side of things that were contemplated in the solid waste management plan. So I think the question is going back to that, and maybe the first step is getting that response from DEM and council on what are your authorities to get things, and get that laid out, and then we can come back and revisit it. Again, now that we're gonna have a solid waste chief that hopefully can work on it.
Well, and I'll tell you that I worked on the first two solid waste advisory plans that were done after we got them mandated. And it still hasn't gotten there. I mean, I've had this discussion for a very long time, and I don't know what I can't figure out what the holdup is, because it's just too simple. I mean, you've got the money in the bank before the product actually arrives on your door to do something with it.
Well, I think
so at least, in theory, it should be costing you less as it goes forward, not more.
Well, I think Elise raised the issue. It'll be a political issue on raising what will be perceived as a tax. Another GET kind of, I know we don't call it a tax, it's a fee. It's another fee. It's more money I have to pay when I go shopping.
Well, you're paying one way or another.
No, I pay my property tax, and it's mystery number that just shows up. And I can go and dive in and see where that property tax money is going. Just like the people who own the buildings that the renters and the tourists are using, they're paying property tax, maybe not enough, but they're paying for it. So what's the deal? They're getting their money. It just isn't right in my face. And you put it in my face, I'm going to get disgruntled, especially now with inflation going up. So, what's another 5%. It'll be a hot potato. One that we want to raise and say, okay, go for it. My first option was at least quantify what the true costs of disposal are and what are the holes we are allowing to continue to happen. There is a cost to the way we dispose of things, and we're not really covering the true cost.
I totally agree with you.
Dee, you have a comment before you have run away?
I'm sorry, but I need to go on to my next commitment. Good to see everybody, and see you in end of September. I'm traveling, and I'll have to look at what our meeting time is at the end of October.
Okay, so, well,
we'll be in touch, and aloha. Bye-bye.
Mahalo.
Ahuiho.
So anyway, I think next steps, you know, I'd like to get for the next meeting, you know, what specifically do we need to know and what do we want to accomplish? I'll go find all that stuff I presented before in discussions to the commission. And if there are any particular items you want to focus on, I'm glad to do that. I'll also, because my memory's gone, look at where we left it with DEM and council on just how far can they go. We had talked as well about enterprise fund on behalf of solid waste in addition to wastewater. And a lot of the hang up and moving forward was who is going to do the work? Because it's not, well, John's going to write a one sentence resolution and it'll occur. It's, there's got to be a lot of analysis done beforehand to lay out why this makes sense. And unfortunately, DEM just has not had the staff to spend time looking at it. So if you will let me, I will work with John some more before the next meeting to try to better hone what it is we want to accomplish this time. And it may be that with a new solid waste chief, his first week on the job may not be the time to lay that all out, maybe October meeting, but let's see what we can pull together. Is that amenable to those who are left? Okay. Moving on to future agenda items, I've got a couple that I've captured here. We'll talk some more about the integrated wastewater management plan, the latest going on the cesspool conversion, and again, talk about or try to figure out how to characterize the idea of doing a annual review or something of what are the things we've recommended and where are they and who do we talk to about why they're still sitting in the in basket. What process should we use and what items would be on that? If there are other topics you want to cover, take them now or take them later. Just email me and try to come up with something. Okay. And then announcements, our next meeting, I guess I put it wrong on my calendar. So hopefully everyone will have it right. We'll be again, September 28th. Is that right, Peter? He'll send out our notice. And we will have Hilo location available. I will also send out the comments that I sent in to the cost of government committee. And if anybody has some additional, I don't, do you know, Kara, are they still taking comments?
They are, yeah.
Okay, are. So if you have some additional comments, you can also pass them on. Anything else I'm missing? Otherwise, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Thank you, Rick. So aloha, ahoiho, and thank you. I think it was a livelier meeting than I anticipated. Also, I presume we will be getting that notice from Monica on her questions. So if we have a vote for adjournment, everyone say aye or click aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.